Now, Washington Mornings on the Mall. 105.9 FM. At AM 630.
WMAL. 707 on WMAL. Brian Neiman, Brian Wilson with you. High drama at the Supreme Court yesterday as the Supreme Court takes up the case of the individual mandate. Took up the case of the individual mandate. Shannon Bream from the Fox News Channel was there. Good morning, Shannon. Great to have you on.
Hey, Shannon.
Good morning, Brian and Brian.
All right, so we have been focused on Justice Kennedy. Let me play a soundbite from him yesterday for you and for the audience and get your reaction to it.
And here the government is saying that the federal government has a duty to tell the individual citizen that it must act. And that is different from what we have in previous cases.
Well,
that changes the relationship of the federal government to the individual in a very fundamental way.
All right. Some people are suggesting...
Changes the relationship in a fundamental way.
A fundamental way. Now, later, I guess he did say that perhaps health care was a unique situation. So what did you take from Justice Kennedy specifically yesterday?
Well, if you took the first hour of the argument, those in the courtroom who are supporters of the law had some very worried looks on their faces when Justice Kennedy spoke. He started right out of the gate by asking a question early on, can you create commerce so that you can regulate it? Of course, that's the argument of conservatives all along, that you're forcing people into an economic transaction to buy something, to do something they don't want to do. And Justice Kennedy did talk a lot about that. You're asking for an affirmative action, somebody to step out and do something. You're telling them to. He seemed very concerned about that. But by the second half of the argument at the end, he was expressing concerns on the other side, saying, I do understand people who don't get insured. I have a concern that their choice not to get insured, even if they think they're young and healthy, they're going to need health care at some point, and that does impact the cost of other people who have gotten insurance.
So what do you think? Because some people have characterized it as, man, the high court was extremely skeptical, and this law may be in trouble. As you listened to those, you were there in the chambers, you heard the entire thing, it's something that none of us had the opportunity to do. What's your sense of it? Still could go either way?
You know what? It definitely could go either way. I think it would be a mistake to count Justice Kennedy as a solid vote either way at this point. And sometimes when they ask questions that seem to be leaning one way, it's simply because they want the attorneys to convince them or to answer that devil's advocate argument. So it's tough to read too much into it. He knows the entire world is watching him and watching these questions. So you have to know that he's very aware of how they were perceived.
All right, any other Easter eggs from any of the other justices? Seems everybody's concentrating on the conservative justices to see if they perhaps side with the government in this case. But did you hear anything from the liberal justices that would indicate that maybe they would go against it?
I got to say no. They all, in fact, I have to say, at the very beginning of the argument yesterday, the Solicitor General, Donald Verrilli, of course, the government's top lawyer, took to the podium to start things. And there were a couple of moments there in the courtroom where, honestly, we thought he might be sick. He was sort of trying to drink water and stammering, and I honestly thought he might physically be having a bit of a problem, whether he needed to cough or he didn't feel good. And it took him a little bit to get started. But once he did, it seemed like the liberal justices gave him a lot of layups. They talked about the fact that, the economic idea of health care, it already is a market. It already exists. Everybody's going to take part in it at some point because you get sick or get in an accident whether you want to or not. They seemed very receptive. It would take something earth-shattering, I think, to sway any of those four votes.
All right. Let me ask you about Sonia Sotomayor. I may be the only person that thinks this, and, I don't follow the Supreme Court, and I'm not a lawyer. But when I was listening to her argue in the second half, she talked about, well, could you put a tax on everyone and then give people a tax credit if they have their own health insurance? And I read that as a way, well, maybe this is unconstitutional. Maybe we can't do this. This would be a workaround. Am I reading that wrong, or did you see that a different way?
No, I agree. I think that they were discussing alternatives and trying to probe if there was another better way Congress could have done this, or even if it's just about semantics at this point. Because, of course, on day one, the government had to argue this is not a tax, because there's a possibility if it was seen as a tax, this lawsuit would be barred at this point, and you couldn't move forward to the merits. But yesterday, there was a lot of talk about how Congress could do this under its taxing power. But then the justices said, well, if you could have done that and maybe avoided some of these other sticky constitutional questions, why didn't Congress just call it a tax? But as you guys remember, it was very unpopular, the idea that you would be instituting any kind of tax increase. So the language was very important, and Congress specifically decided not to refer to this as a tax, as did President Obama.
All right, so first day was, can we hear this at all, given that the law is not in effect? Second day is about the mandate and whether or not it's constitutional. As we head into day three, what will this be focused on?
You have a double header today. This morning they're going to get to the question of severability, meaning can the rest of the law stand if they decide to strike down the mandate, which is a possibility based on the arguments we heard yesterday. The government's going to argue only a couple provisions may be in trouble. They've actually appointed an outside attorney to argue that the entire law can stand on its own. So you'll have three different people arguing that this morning. This afternoon you get to the issue of Medicaid. Under this law, the states would be forced to take millions more people onto their Medicaid rolls. Much of that would be subsidized by the federal government, but the states say they can't afford it, and also there are strings attached because the feds say if you don't go along with this new Medicaid program, we take away all of your Medicaid funding, and the states say it's not right, it's coercion, and they can't afford it.
Let me ask you about the performance of the Solicitor General, because a lot of people were making a note of what you said, that it was kind of a tough start, especially for the Solicitor General, Don Varelli, and that he was getting beat up by a lot of the justices, and he didn't do very well, didn't perform very well. How important is that in this case or in other cases, the actual oral arguments themselves versus what is written down and when the judges go back behind closed doors and make their decision? How much does the performance of either the Solicitor General or other lawyers make a difference in, you know, persuading Supreme Court justices?
Well, it's interesting because you have to think that you know where probably seven or eight of the justices are in a very solid way before they ever came into the argument.
Right.
But I think what's happening in the courtroom really could have an impact in this particular case. There are a lot of folks who say, listen, when you argue a case before the Supreme Court, it's decided on the briefs, they're done. But there are many people who thought what happened in the courtroom on this case, because it's so crucial to sway Justice Kennedy one way or the other, that the oral advocacy really could make a difference. That's the reason that the former Solicitor General, Paul Comet, who's arguing on the behalf of the states challenging the law, he told me that's why he took the case. He said, I really felt like this was one of those cases where what happens with the advocacy could make